Hello, my name is Magnus Petersen. This is my tutorial number 10 on fine-tuning and transfer learning. And this builds on tutorial number 8 and 9, which were made over a year ago. But I couldn't do this tutorial until now because I needed a version of the inception model that didn't have so-called frozen weights. When the weights are frozen, you cannot change them anymore. And that is what we want to do in fine-tuning. The original inception model that I had used, I believe it was implemented in something called TensorFlow Slim, and that was one of these half-baked, incomplete APIs that the TensorFlow developers made, and then they abandoned it. And a lot of you have commented on this thread that you would like to see this as well, but they never really made it. And the way it has to be done is like a model zoo, so it's very easy to use. I had hoped that the estimator API would do this, but that was apparently not the case. I have recently switched to the Keras API, and that has a small model zoo with a few models here. And the documentation actually shows how to use it for fine-tuning with the inception model. The author of Keras has also made this Python notebook, which explains in much more detail what the idea is with transfer learning and fine-tuning and so on. Unfortunately, the code is not really documented, and I found that it took me a few days to get this working on my own dataset, and there are a few tricky issues with how Keras does this. So I think this tutorial is still a valuable contribution. And tutorial number 8 is an explanation of what transfer learning is, and I still recommend that you watch it, even though the actual implementation, I recommend you use Keras instead, which I'm gonna show you in this tutorial here. Now, in this tutorial, we're gonna use the so-called VGG16 model instead of the inception model, and the reason is that the inception model is very complicated, so it's a lot easier to demonstrate what we're gonna do using this simpler model here. So the idea is that we load this pre-trained model, and it has all of these layers, so input layer, 5 convolutional blocks, each of which has several convolutional layers. Then it goes into a dense or fully connected layer, and another fully connected layer, then the output layer for the softmax classification. These 3 last layers are responsible for combining the features that are being recognized in the images by these convolutional layers. So when we want to classify images from a new dataset, we replace these layers and route the output from the last convolutional block to a new fully connected layer. And in this case, we follow it with a dropout layer to try and prevent overfitting so that the classifier will generalize better to unseen data. And then that goes into a softmax classification layer. So the difference between transfer learning and fine-tuning is that in transfer learning, we are only optimizing the weights in this new classifier that we have added to the original model. Whereas in fine-tuning, we will optimize these weights as well as some or all of the weights in the original model. So it might be convolutional block 5 and 4 or even 3, 2, 1 as well. In this example, we only fine-tune the weights in block 4 and 5, but you can experiment and modify the code to try and fine-tune all the weights of the original model as well. As usual, we need a bunch of imports. These are just for Python and TensorFlow. And these are specifically for Keras. And we have a bunch of helper functions. This is for joining a directory and a list of file names. This is for plotting images. This is for printing a confusion matrix. And this is for plotting example errors. And this is a wrapper function for plotting the example errors. This one processes all the images in the test set in the new model that we have created. And I should note something important here, which is that in Keras, we will use data generators to iterate over our training and test sets. And I will explain in a moment how these are implemented. But the thing is that these generators will iterate for infinity over the data sets. So in order to make sure that we always start at the beginning of the test set, we need to reset an internal counter in the generator. Otherwise, it might start in the middle or at whatever index it might have ended in the previous call for getting data from this generator. And because we need to match the predicted output of the new model with a file name for it, an image in the test set, we need to make sure that when we run this prediction, that it starts at the beginning of the test set. And this is one of the things that it took me a while to figure this out, why I had these strange bugs coming up in my code somewhere. So these datasets are not actually loaded into memory, and when we want to plot them, for example, we need to load the images first, and this helper function does that. Here we have a helper function for plotting the training history, because Keras records the loss values and the classification accuracy on the training set and the validation or the test set. We don't use a validation set here, we just use a test set, because our data set is so small. So the data set we're going to use is the Knifey Spoony data set that we created in tutorial 9, and we downloaded and extracted using this function here. But Keras needs a different directory structure than is originally in this dataset, so I made a little function for just copying the files. It's a fairly small dataset, so it's only like, I don't know, maybe 30 megabytes or so, so it shouldn't be a problem to just copy the files. And now the training set is in one directory and the test set is in another directory. Each of those have subdirectories with the name of each class, and the Keras API can then read this directly. So here we have the function call in Keras for loading the pre-trained model. And this function will automatically download the model from the internet if you don't have it already. Now if we go back and look at the flowchart, you can download two models. You can download the full model, which includes the top layers for doing this classification here at the end. If you do that, it's over 500 megabytes. Or you can download just the convolutional part of the model. That's a bit over 50 megabytes. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you in a moment how the original model classifies some images, so we need this part of the model as well. If you're on a slow internet connection, then you can modify the code so you only download the model that has the convolutional layers. But notice how elegant this is in Keras. It's just one function call. So now we have to set up our new input pipeline from our new dataset into the Keras model. And this is a bit awkward, because it needs several steps. First, we need to know the input shape of the model. So we take the model that we just loaded, the VGG16 pre-trained model. We get a list of all the layers. We take the first one, which is the input layer. We get the output shape of that layer. And then we get the relevant part of that shape, which is the width and height of the image. Or it might be the height and the width, I can't remember. But it's the same number here, so it doesn't really matter. Then we need to create the data generator, and Keras has a built-in generator for images, which can do a number of random transformations each time an image is loaded from the training set. First of all, we will rescale the pixel values, so they fall between 0 and 1, instead of 0 and 255, which is normal for an image. The pre-trained model expects the pixel values to be between 0 and 1. Then we can randomly rotate the image. And we can shift the image on each of the axes, and we can zoom it and do various other transformations. And Keras can save all of these images to disk while it is training, so that we can inspect and see if they have been distorted too much. So we need to lower these parameters for the random transformation. So let's have a look at a few of these images. This is obviously a spoon, another spoon, spoon again. This is a knife. This is a fork. And what has probably happened here is that it has zoomed it down a little, and then it takes the pixels from the edges of the image, and then it copies them. But we can still see this is a fork, so this is all right. Okay, so let's go back to the notebook. And we also need a data generator for the test set. We don't want any random transformations there, because we want to know the classification accuracy for those specific images without any transformations. The only thing we need to do is to rescale the pixel values so they are once again between 0 and 1. Now the data generators will return batches of images, because TensorFlow needs batches so it can work more efficiently. And because the VGG16 model is so large, we need a fairly small batch size, which we set to 20. If it crashes for you, you will have to lower this. And if we want to save the transformed images during training, then we have to set the directory where we want to save it. And this directory needs to exist, so you need to create this, otherwise the code will crash. Now this is slightly awkward, because once we have set up the data generator, we have to sort of finalize it by saying we want to read images from a directory. So we give it the training directory, then we also need to say the target size of the images that we want to read, so it can automatically resize them. And again, this is a little strange why that is here and not above, where we created the data generator and had all the image transformations already. And then we give it the batch size, and whether or not we want to randomly shuffle the data, we want to do that for the training set, but not for the test set. And then if we want to save the images to a directory, as I explained. Now this tells us that it found 4,170 images in three different classes in that directory. If we do the same for the test set, except we set shuffle to false because we want the images returned in the same order every time we call this generator, it says that it found 530 images in the test set over those three classes. Now this has not loaded anything, it has just created the data generators that Keras can use to get data into a model and use that for training or testing. These data generators will loop for eternity, so we need to specify the number of steps that we want to run during training and testing. And we will get to the training further below, but during testing, we always want to make a full processing of the test set. So we take the number of images in the test set, which was 530, and we divide it by the batch size, which is 20. And this gives us 26 and a half steps to get one full processing of the test set. Now, I actually think that Keras only uses a half batch for the last batch. So instead of 20 images, it uses 10 images for the last batch, because when we run this with 26 and a half steps and a batch size of 20, we actually process 530 images. But as I explained above, the data generator has this internal counter, and if we don't reset it, it starts at different places each time we call it, and this might suggest that it is actually not processing the full test set. So I'm not sure what goes on here. But anyway, let's move on. And here we get all the file paths for the training set and the test set, if we want to plot some of those images later. And here we have the true classes for the training set and the test set. And here we have the names of the different classes. And we have the number of classes. And we can plot a few images just to see if the data is correct. So here we have an image of a fork, and a fork, and a fork. And actually these are all images of forks because these file names are not randomly ordered. First we have the fork class, and then we have the other classes. What you should note here is that some of these are actually really hard to see for a human. This one is really hard to see. This one is hard. This one is hard. This one could be a spoon. This is easy. This is easy. But yeah, this is not an easy data set, so we should not expect to get 100% classification accuracy, and especially because the test set, as we will see below, is made on a completely different background. Now, another problem with this test set is that it is quite imbalanced, because I think it has about twice as many images of spoons as it has images of forks. So we can use scikit-learn to calculate class weights so that when we are processing a whole batch during training, we will weight each sample by the corresponding weight here, depending on which class the image is. This means that the gradient for a fork image is amplified slightly, and the gradient for a spoon image is lowered slightly, so that the model should learn more from fork images than from spoon images. I'm not sure this works completely as intended, but this is something you can experiment with in the exercises as well. So let's try a few example predictions using the pre-trained VGG16 model. And for this, we need a short helper function. We first need to load and resize the image, and we use the PL library for Python to do that, and then we can plot it. Then we have to convert the image to a NumPy array with the proper shape, and then we can use the pre-trained model to predict what the image might show. This returns an array with 1,000 numbers, one for each of the classes in the ImageNet dataset that the VGG16 model was trained on. And this is just one call in the Keras API. And then we need to decode the predictions, so we get the actual class name and the score out, and then we can print it. So let's try it on this image of a parrot. And the VGG16 model says that it is fairly confident that this image shows a macaw, which is a species of parrot. I don't know if this is a macaw, but it's certainly a parrot. And then these other scores are really just noise because they are so low. I prefer to call these scores rather than probabilities, because it's not really a probability in the traditional sense of the word. It's more like a score. So let's try and use the VGG16 model on one of our images from our new dataset. And here it is very confused. It gives a score around 31% that this might be a mosquito net, or maybe a shower curtain. But it's really very uncertain about what this shows. So let's try it with another image from the training set. And this is a bit hard to see, but it is actually a fork. But here it is very confused. The pre-trained model thinks that this might be a quill, but it's a very low score of only 9.7%. Or it might be a ladle with a score of 7%, or a screwdriver. This is just noise. It really doesn't know what it is. It's totally confused about what the image shows. Now here's an image from the test set. And as you will note, it is made on a completely different background. This is the backyard of some friends of mine in Poland. And as you can see, it has a lot of weeds. And not the smoking kind of weed, but just weed. But anyway, the pre-trained model thinks that this might be a orangutan or a spider monkey. But again, the scores are very low, so it is very confused. So the pre-trained BGG16 model was completely unable to classify the images in our knifey spoony dataset. And the reason might be that the model was trained on the so-called ImageNet dataset, and that might not have contained many images of cutlery. What we're going to do now is to use the pre-trained model in transfer learning, which we also explained in tutorial number 8, and I encourage you to watch that video. It gives more details about transfer learning than here, and shows you actually what the values look like that we are transferring from the original model to our new classifier. So this is what we want to do. We want to ignore this part of the original model, and we add a new fully connected layer, and in our case also a dropout layer to try and control overfitting, and then a softmax classification layer. As I mentioned before, during transfer learning, we will only train the weights in this new classifier here. We will not modify the weights in the original model. The idea is that the original model can recognize patterns and shapes in images, and then the classifier will combine these patterns and shapes so it can recognize, oh, this is a fork or a knife or a spoon. So let's see how we're going to do that. Keras has this very handy summary function which we can call on the model, and it prints out all the layers in the output shape and the number of parameters. So here we can see that the model has input layer, convolutional blocks, and so on, all the way down to a flattened layer, fully connected or dense layers, and the softmax classification layer. And you can see these last three layers are really the ones that have the most weights in them. So if you only download the model that doesn't have these layers here, it's much smaller. Now you should note that the last layer of the last convolutional block is called block 5 pool. So this is the layer where we will take the output and route it into our new classifier. So using the Keras API, we can get a reference to this layer very easily by calling this function on the model. And we can see that the output of this layer has this shape here. So we will need to flatten this in order to output this into a fully connected or a dense layer. So the way we are going to reuse the pre-trained VGG16 model is very easy in Keras. We create a new Keras model, give it as input the input from the VGG16 model, and we give it the output of the transfer layer that we just got. So this is the block 5 pool layer. If we go back and look at the flowchart, what we have created here is a new model that is reusing this part of the original VGG16 model. So from the input layer up to the fifth convolutional block. And it is also reusing the weights. These are the same weights. It's actually the same model. We are just creating references into this model. And now we will also use Keras to add these layers here. So let's go back down and see how that is done. So here we have the reference to the convolutional part of the original model, and then we can start a new Keras sequential model because we just want to add a few more layers, and this is the easiest way to do it in Keras. So we start by adding the convolutional model from the pre-trained VGG16 model that we made a reference to up here. Then we add a flattening layer because we need to flatten the output of the convolutional layer so we can input it to a fully connected or dense layer, which we add here. And then we add a dropout layer because we are trying to prevent overfitting so that the new model will generalize better to unseen data. And then we add a final layer for the actual classification using softmax. Then we specify that we want to use the ADOM optimizer with a fairly low learning rate, and we will use the categorical cross entropy as the loss function, and the only metric that we are interested in is the categorical classification accuracy. Now by default, all of the layers in the pre-trained model are trainable, and we make this little helper function that can show us that. So you see, these are all the layers in the pre-trained model, and the trainable Boolean is true in all of these layers. Now we want to do transfer learning first. Let's go back to the flowchart. So right now, the trainable Boolean is true in this entire original VGG16 model and the new classifier that we have added. The problem is that this is only randomly initialized. So if we run the training now, we will have some large errors from the last layers that will propagate backwards through this original pre-trained model, and this will distort the pre-trained weights. Now, it can be done if you have a very low learning rate, but there's great risk of overfitting to the dataset. So what we're going to do instead in transfer learning is that we're going to disable the training of all the layers and weights in the original model so that we are only updating the weights in this new classifier that we have added. So if we go back to the code, we will see that all of these trainable booleans are true, and we are now going to set them to false. Now, the new model that we have created refers to the part of the old pre-trained model as the conv model, and this has a trainable boolean by itself. I'm not sure if this boolean overrides the individual booleans in the pre-trained model, so what we're going to do is we're just going to set them all to false. And if we then print them out again, we will see that they have now all been set to false in the pre-trained model. Now, once this has been done, we need to compile the Keras model so it knows which optimizer to use, loss function, metrics, but also for these trainable booleans to take effect. If we don't compile the model, they will have no effect. Now, before we do the training on the model, we need to define the number of epochs and the number of steps per epoch. And this is, again, another thing of the Keras API, which is maybe not so elegant. The data generators from above will generate batches for infinity. And the way this is implemented in Keras is that we have to define the number of steps per epoch. So we set this to 100, and this is multiplied by the batch size of 20. So this is one epoch. Actually, this is not a full run of the training set, but the thing is that Keras only records one data point after each epoch, and this training run takes 6 to 7 minutes on a GTX 1070 GPU, and I wanted 20 data points out so we can plot a meaningful graph. But you're probably going to experiment a little with these numbers for your own dataset. So anyway, if we do the training run, and this is done in Keras using the fit generator, so it will take training batches from the generator for the training set that we defined above, run 20 epochs with 100 batches for each epoch, and it will use the class weights that we defined above to try and rebalance this imbalance that is between the different classes in our dataset. And then after each epoch, we will record the performance on the validation set. We don't use a validation set. We just use the test set, and it looks like this when we run it. And in the tutorial number 3 on the Keras API, this didn't look so well, but I found that it was actually not a bug in the Keras API, it was a bug in Jupyter. So when I upgraded Jupyter, it looks fine. So after training has finished, we can plot the classification accuracies and the loss values for the training set and the test set. So I think for the training set, it's just maybe some kind of moving average of the last few batches. I'm not exactly sure, but it's definitely not for the whole training set. But the classification accuracy on the loss value for the test set is for the whole test set because we instructed it to calculate that. So what we see here with those blue dots are the loss values for the training set, or for a few of the training batches at least, and that goes down steadily. But if we look at the loss values for the test set, which are these red dots, they are more erratic, and towards the end, they actually go up. And if we look at the classification accuracy, we have it for the test set here as the dashed red lines, and that also goes down towards the end. This might indicate overfitting, but if you rerun this, you will see that sometimes it goes up and sometimes it goes down towards the end. So there's a random effect here. But for the training set, the classification accuracy goes up as the loss values go down. And we can also calculate the classification accuracy on the test set, and we see it gets 66.60% after the training. And we can plot some examples of misclassified images, and this is really a knife, but it was predicted as a fork, and it is the same for all of these images. And we can see from the confusion matrix that what has happened is that it is very good at classifying images of forks as forks, but it is very confused about images of knives, which it usually classifies as forks, and the images of spoons are also often misclassified as forks. Now, this brings us to fine-tuning, because the problem might be that the convolutional layers of the pre-trained model are incapable of distinguishing between the relevant features in these types of images. So if we go back and look at the flowchart, what we want to do now is that we want to fine-tune the weights in these layers that we have added, as well as the weights in some or all of the layers in the pre-trained model. So in this example that we're going to do now, we will just fine-tune the weights in the fourth and fifth convolutional blocks of the original model. And if we go back to the code, we will now have to enable the trainable Boolean for those relevant layers. So again, I'm not sure if this reference to the convolutional part of the pre-trained model is overriding all of the Booleans for those individual layers in that model, but we will set this to true. And then for the layers which have either block 5 or block 4 in the layer name, we will set those to true as well. And then we can print out those trainable Booleans, and we will see that the relevant ones have been set to true. We will then use an optimizer with a lower learning rate because we want to do this fine-tuning very gently to the pre-trained model so we don't distort the weights that it already has. But you can experiment with a higher learning rate here and see what result that you're going to get. And for all of this to take effect, we need to recompile the model again. And then we just do another training run like so. So the classification accuracy on the training set goes up gradually, and this is also the case for the test set, and we can see that the loss values also go down gradually. So it seems that this has worked. But this depends on a lot of factors, including the pre-trained model, where we take the transfer layer, the data set, the learning rate, and so on. So if you use this on another data set, you will have to experiment with all of these parameters. But the result we got out now is a classification accuracy on the test set of 79.25%. I should mention that if you rerun this notebook, you might actually get a classification accuracy of 80% from just doing the transfer learning. So these are random numbers because the training is randomized. It starts with random weights for the new classification layers, and there might also be some randomization in the Ada optimizer. In this example here, it looks like the fine-tuning has helped us a lot. But again, if you rerun this notebook, you will see that it may not actually help in all cases because the transfer learning itself might find a very good solution. Again, this depends on your dataset, the pre-trained model, and all of the parameters that you choose. So if we plot a few example errors from the test set again, this image was a fork, it was predicted as a spoon, and this is fairly easy to see for a human. This one is really hard to see, it is still a fork but predicted as a spoon, and this one is also easy to see for a human, it's a fork but once again it was misclassified as a spoon. So if we look at the confusion matrix again, we will see that the images that are actually forks have been correctly classified most of the time, but images of knives were often misclassified as forks, and images of spoons were sometimes misclassified as forks. So this tutorial has showed you how to do transfer learning and fine-tuning using the Keras API, and this was much, much easier than doing it directly in TensorFlow. My blood pressure has come down, my hair is starting to grow back, the sun is shining, and life is good when you're using Keras. Now again, whether fine-tuning improves on the classification accuracy over just using transfer learning depends on the pre-trained model, the transfer layer that you choose, the dataset that you have, how you train the new model, and so on. And you will probably have to experiment with all of these issues. As always, you can download this notebook by clicking on the link below the video.